Good evening and a warm welcome to everyone. My name is Saju Casey from HDFC Securities, and we have joined for this webinar on the ongoing Invesco Global Consumer Trends Fund of Fund, which opened on 4th of December and is going to close on 18th of December 2020. So we have Nilesh Dhamanskar, Fund Manager from Invesco, and Sandhir Sharma, Retail Sales Head from Invesco, who is going to help us understand, why this fund should be there in our portfolio and what it has got in it, that is going to help the investors to create a wealth over a period of time. So over to you, Sandhir.
Thank you, Saju, and a very warm welcome to all of you for this discussion on our launch of our Fund of Fund, Invesco Global India Invesco Global Consumer Trends Fund of Fund. Hope you and your families are doing well, and you are in good spirits and good health. Take care, stay safe. What we will do is I'll briefly, quickly actually touch upon what exactly is the fund all about, and then hand it over to Nilesh Dhamanskar, who is the domestic fund manager for this fund. When we look at around Baljan, we can move to the next slide. So when we look around and when we observe, there are changes which are actually happening in consumer behavior and preferences, and these changes are actually happening at a faster pace, not only in India, but if you look around, these changes are actually happening at a faster pace across the globe, especially last 10-15 years. We can see the trend that the pace of change is actually increased. So the way we shop, the way we actually travel, the way we interact with people and consume entertainment, everything is changing. And these changes broadly are driven by three important factors. What we are saying, that one is obviously connectivity, second is digitization, and third is demographics. So these three are actually driving all the changes. To capture these, and benefit from these changes which are actually happening, and these secular trends, we are pleased to share that we are launching our fund of fund, which is Invesco India Invesco Global Consumer Trends Fund of Fund. Please move to the a couple of slides. Yeah, next, please. Yeah. So in terms of benefits, you go to the previous slide, please. Go to the previous slide. Yeah. So in terms of just to quickly actually highlight the benefits of why you should be investing into global markets. One is diversification and low correlation. By what we mean is that if you see around and if you look around all your assets, mostly you will have a home country bias. So whether you look at your physical assets or more mainly your financial assets, so whether it is physical assets like real estate or gold or even your financial assets, whether you are actually investing into mutual funds or bonds, or you have money in fixed deposit, or you have in post office, all the other you can say venues of financial assets as well. Bulk of the there is always a home country bias. Everyone will have bulk of their assets actually based out of the home country. So by diversification, what we mean is that not only you should diversify across asset classes, but it makes sense to actually diversify across other markets as well beyond your home market. So what we have seen is that different markets actually perform at different points of time. Winners do rotate across, you can say, markets as well. And it makes sense to actually invest into global markets and go beyond your home country. And what has been also seen is that there is low correlation between various markets, global markets. So then that is another reason why you should be actually looking at global markets. But more importantly, why we are saying that you should be looking at global markets is also that you get exposure to those kind of businesses which are not available in India. So there will be businesses which are doing business in India, but they are not actually listed in India. For example, we have seen a couple of examples in the earlier slide, whether it is Amazon, Facebook, Netflix. We are using their products and services, but if we want to participate in their in them, obviously they are not listed in India. So we have to go to global markets to invest into these kind of names. Similarly, there are business lines, there are sectors which are maybe an unorganized player in India, or they are not present in India. So maybe Nilesh will actually touch upon more in detail. But yes, to case in point is maybe a gaming or a home improvement, which is an unorganized player in India, where we do have listed names across the globe. So these are the important reasons why you should be actually looking at global markets. Apart from that, to this fund, obviously, what we are saying is it is also a differentiated strategy in that sense, because what this fund does is basically it is actually investing into those kind of secular consumer preferences or trends or behaviors which are actually emerging. And what we have seen is that the overlay or the overlay of the product which is there, which is this product, as compared to the products which are available in global space currently, there is hardly 10 to 12% overlay with the those funds. So it's a true differentiator in that sense. Just move to the next slide, Bajan. So in terms of structure, the product actually is structured as a fund of fund. This fund, which Indian investors would be investing into, it's a feeder fund, which is called Invesco India, Invesco Global Consumer Trends Fund of Fund. This whatever money is collected in this fund, this will be invested into the underlying fund, which is Invesco Global Consumer Trends Fund, which has more than two decades of track record. So 95 to 100% whatever money is collected will be invested into the underlying parent fund. And maybe 0 to 5% would be actually managed for cash purposes to maintain for meeting of redemption requirements as well. So coming to the broad contours of the fund, in terms of as we highlighted, it's a multi-cap strategy. It is 40 to 50% of the portfolio would be into mid and small cap segment. And there are two important consumer decisions based on which actually this portfolio invests: how a customer is actually spending his time, and how the consumer is spending his money. So these are two important pillars based on which actually the fund decides where it should be investing. To give you more color on that, I would now hand over to Nilesh. So over to you, Nilesh.
Yeah, thanks, Sandeer. Thanks for the introduction. So hi, everyone. Now let me take you through the details of the underlying fund. So before getting into the nitty-gritties, let me explain you what the core philosophy of this fund is, of the underlying fund is. It essentially is a consumer-oriented fund which only invests in a focused set of companies which are largely beneficiaries of secular trends. And if I were to give you a brief about this fund in a nutshell, so it basically uses a multi-thematic approach to capture secular changes happening in the consumer behavior. And these behaviors are happening not just in a particular region, but across the world. So that's one commonality with which we select stocks with. Again, as Sandeer mentioned, in terms of the key thought process which goes with respect to selecting the stocks is that, the fund managers, the team basically ask themselves two key questions, which basically all the consumers ask themselves at all points of time, which is, where should I spend my time on, and where should I spend my money on? So the companies which are benefiting from these decisions, okay, consumer decisions, are basically bought into our fund. So if I were to just briefly tell you about the underlying fund, it's a fairly old fund, an existing fund which has been there since the last 22 years. Its current AUM is about $3.5 billion. This is slightly older data. Since it's an essentially consumer focused fund, it's indexed against MSCI World Consumer Discretionary Index. Again, I forgot to mention one thing, that this fund invests in consumer oriented companies globally. It is not restricted to any particular country or region. Coming to the typical holding constituent companies, it ranges between 60 to 75. In terms of the stock selection methodology, it's a rigorous bottom-up stock selection methodology with some amount of thematic approach and top-down element also woven into it. And in terms of the typical holding period, since a lot of the companies which we own are secular in nature, I mean, the holding pattern for majority of the companies are 2 to 3 years. In one key highlight of this fund is 70%, a majority of the portion of the fund is exposed to beneficiaries of secular trends, that is trends which are new age consumer themes, okay, and a good balance, about 25-30% of the fund is exposed to the cyclical slash industries which are going through transient themes, okay, some cyclical themes or transient secular themes which are happening. So that's a broad construct of the fund. Let me kind of explain to you what we own under each of this under various buckets through this pie chart, which is you can see on the right hand side. So as Sandeer mentioned, so what which I'll probably explain it to you in detail with respect to the themes. The what are the themes which we like based on which we have selected these stocks. So the themes. So the we believe that the world is changing over the last few years. And it is happening because of three important reasons. One is the increasing internet connectivity. Second is the rising smartphone penetration. So people are doing a lot more than what they were earlier doing with their phone. And lastly, demographics. The newer generation has a completely different set of choices and preferences, which are benefiting certain different set of companies. So now let me explain you. So what we have done in this pie chart is bucketed the companies which we own based on the key you can say buckets. Okay, so first and foremost the bucket wherein we own, which forms the most largest component of our portfolio, is e-com, internet and direct retail. So the most obvious beneficiaries of rising internet connectivity and smartphone penetration is e-commerce. People are increasingly buying stuff online. Okay, earlier they used to buy things through retail stores, going to hypermarkets and etc. But increasingly, with the kind of convenience it offers, people are increasingly buying it on e-commerce. So resultantly, what we own over here is are say companies like Amazon, which is a prominent e-com company, not just in US but in many countries. We also own the top two e-com companies based out of China, which is Alibaba and as well as JD.com. These are number one and number two in China. We also own a Southeast Asia based e-com as well as gaming a company which is both into gaming as well as e-com. The name is C Limited, which has a strong platform, and it is at a very you can say early stage of evolution. It was probably at the similar stage where Alibaba was 7-8 years back. Again, a prominent holding in this under this basket. Then we also own a company named Farfetch, which is a prominent retailer, online retailer in the luxury space. For reasons, Amazon as well as the prominent e-com players have not been able to make inroads in the luxury e-com space. But it's companies like Farfetch with a lot of tie-ups with luxury good manufacturer. They are at the forefront. It's a UK-based company doing extremely well on the e-commerce online business. We also over here we also own one food package delivery company. Basically, they make your customized food, or customized foods which are delivered to the customers. Again, a food tech oriented company which we own, but with a lot of online presence. So this is broadly the what we own under this basket. Again, a trend. These companies have been doing since the last 5 years. We believe this very set of companies would continue to do well 3 years down the line, 5 years down the line, with the kind of dominance they have achieved in the scale as well as operations. Second important bucket is the experiences, restaurants, hotels, and casinos. So that forms about 22% of our portfolio. Now, what we own over here are two broad buckets, subgroups, I would say. One is the quick service restaurants, and the other is regional casinos. Now, what we could see, why we own quick service restaurants? These are the company. These are the very popular restaurant chains in developed countries, particularly USA. To name a few, we own companies like BJ Restaurants or companies like Jack in the Box, which is a prominent burger retail chain based out of US. Then you have got Restaurant International Inc., which is the parent which owns the Burger King franchise, the franchise got recently listed. Indian franchise is going to get listed now. So we own the parent of that entity, which is available at a very very cheap valuations and very, very attractive valuations. They also own another very well-known franchisee named Tim Hortons, very popular joint. So and many such kind of franchisees within itself. These QSRs are not just expected to benefit from the normalization, which is going to happen as things recover from stay at home to people moving, venturing out and doing things what they were earlier doing, as well as the fact that they are also, again, consumer-oriented trends which are there for here to stay. Increasingly, the newer generation also prefers to have things quickly. Okay, so it's a combination of both. The second important sub-bucket in this is the regional casinos. So what has happened in the US in the last 6-9 months is that a lot of state governments in US have regularized online gambling and sports betting. And actually, gambling was only earlier allowed in the state of Nevada, where Las Vegas is. So now with the broad basing of this avenue, a lot of these states are going to kind of allow this in their own states. Resultantly, the casinos or the regional resorts which are there in those states are benefiting. So we own two companies. One is Caesars Entertainment and the other is Penn National Gaming. Both the companies have very strong presence. They have those casinos, resorts, as well as tie-ups on the sports betting side ready with them, and they are and this is a completely new set of revenue stream which is here to stay for many years of time. Okay, it will take away some market share from Nevada state. So we own these two companies. We also own one company named EPR Properties, which is you can say beneficiary of a normalization after some time, you can say. So it's a REIT which offers which gives on lease its properties, and one of its major tenant is a multiplex chain operator. As in when the theaters are allowed, obviously these companies which are available at a very extremely cheap valuations, I think they will kind of do well. So this bucket is more a combination of these transient themes as well as some cyclical names. Coming to the third important bucket, which is the video games and entertainment software. Now this is a very important bucket for us. We have always owned companies in this bucket, and we have always had exposure between 15 to 30% to this bucket, and this has over the years given us a huge a good outperformance vis-a-vis the benchmark. Why we like gaming, I will probably explain in one of the slides ahead, but essentially this is one avenue which is benefiting from the increasing shift from people playing games on your PCs or consoles to people playing games on mobiles. Okay, increasingly that shift we are essentially trying to capture, as well as the proclivity of a lot of younger generation to play games. Okay, so what we own over here is a good bouquet of 6 to 7 gaming companies. So if I were to give you some examples, so you have got companies like EA Sports, which I'm probably hoping that some of you may have played games. I have certainly played games made by EA Sports many years back. So they are the major franchisee owners of games like Need for Speed or FIFA. So they own a lot of these sports-oriented games, very, very popular games globally. Then we have also a company named Activision Blizzard, which is arguably the number one gaming company in the world. They own a lot of franchisee or titles within themselves. And if I were to quote a few of their franchisees, Call of Duty is one popular game, which is the most played multiplayer game globally. They also own the entity which are the makers of a lot of these mobile games. Okay, so these companies have good amount of exposure to these mobile games. Candy Crush is one of the games which is made by Activision entity. Then you've got companies like Ubisoft, which has prominent titles like Assassin's Creed. Then you've got companies, console manufacturers like Nintendo. As well as one very prominent gaming developer based out of Central Europe, which is known to be the makers of very prominent games. So we and all these companies are doing extremely well, available at reasonable valuations, and they have a couple of other catalysts also, which is resulting which we are owning a good proportion, and we will continue to own a good proportion in this fund. Next comes the internet and social media over here. So obviously as people with smartphones, one of the areas where we all spend time is on Facebook or on Google or on YouTube. So these are this bucket has those set of companies. So just Paljinder, go to the next slide. Previous slide only. Yes, it's this only. Facebook is one company. Then you've got Alphabet, which owns Google as well as YouTube. Then you've got some online dating companies listed in the US as well as in China, as well as one more company, which the Russian equivalent, Russia's Google, which is called Yandex. Okay, so this is the these are the companies we, which we own under this basket. The next biggest basket, which forms about 7% of the fund, is basically US durables and durable retail. See what we own. See what is happening in US is that since the last 1 year, there's a huge amount of housing shortage happening in US. There's a supply crunch of what you call housing units in USA. Resultantly, a lot of houses are getting built in US, and parallelly, a lot of houses are getting renovated. A lot of people are sitting at home and they want their houses to be refurbished. So all the these trends are resulting into a huge boom for construction material being sold. And so we are capturing that through by owning specialty retailers or housing material, which basically sell housing home construction equipment and those materials. So we own a company named Lowe's under this basket. Again, a very good industry and benefiting immensely from this. We also own a couple of EPC manufacturers who help make homes in US, okay, build bungalows or smaller villas in US, which is again a beneficiary of this trend. So the other smaller components, which again are prominent secular in nature, some of their media distribution. Again, Netflix is one area which is completely taking away market share from the traditional TV oriented TV or other medium oriented entertainment avenues. So we own Netflix over here, as well as Sony, which is benefiting from the increased prevalence of these digital music downstreaming apps, okay, like Spotify or Gaana. So Sony having a lot of content, they are benefiting, they are able to sell that content to them, indirectly benefiting. There are some other names. One last, if I were to say, is in the active lifestyle, what we in this bucket, we own companies which are benefiting from the increased preference towards outdoor activities or health conscious lifestyle by the younger generation. So they prefer the apparel wear, sportswear or shoes which are used for trekking or gymming equipments, home gymming equipments. So we own companies like Wolverine Worldwide or Nautilus, which is a home gymming equipment provider. So these are the companies which we own under this bucket. So let me kind of explain you some a bit later. Balchandra, go to the next slide. Yeah, so this is the team which manages this fund. So it is a very experienced team which sitting out of US. It's a 4-member team. All of them are very experienced, more than carrying almost 20 years experience behind them. And the same team has been managing this fund since the last 9 years. So there's a good degree of consistency and continuity of thought process for this fund. Next. Yeah, now I just briefly told you about what all the companies which we own. Now let me quickly explain you why we own each of these companies. So as I told you, we have identified about 5 to 7 themes which are very, very secular in nature. What I mean by secular meaning they were there 3 years back. These trends are there currently. The same trends are going to be there 3 years down the line, 5 years down the line, 10 years down the line. So the first and foremost prominent trend is the rising internet connectivity. So earlier it was happening via PCs, which was happening at a very slow pace. But post the advent of smartphones, it has got accelerated. And the companies which have woven their business models around these internet as well as smartphones, I mean, they are the set of companies which are benefiting and not necessarily the traditional set of companies. Next. Yeah, now the first and foremost and the most obvious beneficiary is the e-commerce, people increasingly buying stuff online. So this is the trend. In fact, over the years, if you see, it has always been picking up, but during COVID, you can see it accelerate. What we believe is that in any technology adoption curve, which goes through a S curve, we believe that we are at that inflection point, And from here on, we expect things to accelerate further and for the over the next 5 to 7 years before they kind of mature. And one thing which we are already seeing is that grocery, which was earlier bought by actually people going to the stores, is increasingly bought by people online. And this forms about 30 to 40% of the overall of the retail, overall retail, non-auto retail basket. So you can imagine the kind of potential it offers and the acceleration it is expected to see. Next. This is again the depiction of the same trend through the from the other side. See, over the years, the footfalls at the brick and mortar retail outlets in US has continuously been falling by about 5 to 7%. This is a function of a lot of stores closing down, people increasingly preferring convenience over actually going over there. And what we could see during COVID, it just crashed. So obviously the beneficiaries of them were the e-com companies like Amazon or JD.com, which I spoke about. But what we believe as this is a reflection of a trend to come. Obviously it will normalize a bit, but the trend, the path is very clear that the brick and mortar companies are losing out to the e-com companies, which come with them, which bring with them a lot of what do you call network effects and a lot of convenience at play. Next. Now this is where this is an important slide. I talked about that one of the core decision making criteria is are the companies which we are buying are benefiting from the consumer decision of where he wants to spend his time on. So now let's see, so on the left hand side of the chart depicts where people have been spending their time on. So if you really see over the last many years, it's the mobile, which is increasingly, taking away a lot of share of a typical user, okay, typical consumer. And it is coming at the cost of certain other avenues. Resultantly, a lot of these companies which we are owning under our portfolio are particularly benefiting from this trend, which is very prevalent. On the right hand side, what you see is the revenue, the viewership share of that medium versus the share of that medium in the ad market. So what we are seeing is the mobile as currently is about 34%, which maybe just 3 years back, 3-4 years back was less than 20%. But it is still kind of underrepresented, and it has a long runway for growth from here on. In some of the developed countries, it has already reached 60%. Next. Now, so I'll spend slightly 2 minutes over here. This is why this chart basically tells you why we like gaming. Now, gaming for a lot of people who are not familiar with is a very large industry globally, about $170 billion. Industry much larger than some of the even the TV industry also. So it is growing at a very healthy rate. But what is happening within the industry structure is that two subcomponents are doing extremely well, which is one is this green thing. Basically you have to see the uppermost left hand side chart. The green color one, which is mobile advertising, is growing at a very high rate. And similarly, the console digital, which is downloading games on the console directly and not playing them through CDs or DVDs. That is what these two components are growing very well. And why is that happening? Because of the increased graphic processing capabilities, which we are seeing in the chipsets of the phones. To put things in perspective, games which required a high-end PC with graphic card, 5 years back, they can now be played on a smartphone and with the same kind of experience. So resultantly, the mobile piece is growing very high at a very high rate. In fact, you can see that increasingly people during the commute are playing a lot of games, so which is a clear trend. And just imagine when the high-end games now are offered on to be played on mobiles, it kind of expands the market by about 6x. Now coming to the representation of the viewers of gaming on the advertising industry side, it's very underrepresented. A lot of people prefer to watch people play games. Okay, so that audience is about 454 million. but it is very, very underrepresented in terms of the advertising revenue, which is just $1.1 billion. We believe that this is a very under index at this point of time, and this is expected to go up and increasingly benefiting the gaming companies also. Next, Balchandra, next. So this is again, this is the music industry. The revenues coming from music, what referring to through those music streaming apps. So which has resulted in the industry actually going up and benefiting companies, which I already spoke about. The last category which I want to speak about is the athletic apparel wear category, which again I benefited from the health consciousness aspects revolving the newer generation. It is benefiting, which is very visible in this trend. Sandeep, go to the directly to the getting out of jail slide. Balchandra, go to slide number 20. Balchandra?
Yeah, I already.
Next. Slide number 20. Yes. Just be here. So now I briefly spoke about what we own, what are the themes which we like. Now, basically, I'll quickly explain you how we have tried to act and ensure that with these overall thought process, how we have enacted that with respect to the opportunities which we were given during the last 1 year. So now, as you would have seen, the majority of the portion which we own are secular beneficiaries. A lot of them indirectly also benefited from the stay at home aspects which were very visible during COVID. So this chart basically talks about the steps which a typical consumer will take as things normalize. So initially, when he was at home, he was buying stuff online or ordering food online at home or playing games, watching Netflix. But as things have started normalizing, he started taking initial steps. Okay. So what we did during the month of March, April was that we got a very strong what you call boost to our constituent. I mean, a lot of the gaming stocks as well as some of the stay at home beneficiaries did well for us. But what we did is we rotated some of the money into step one and step two beneficiaries in the month of April and May. Okay, what it did is that it kind of balanced the portfolio to some extent, and some of the stocks which were slightly pricey, we rotated that money into some of the companies which were available at extremely cheap valuations, which later on did extremely well and benefited the entire portfolio. So what we did is step one is we bought a lot of these QSR quick service restaurants, which I spoke about. We also bought some of these ride sharing app companies or these regional casinos, which again are non-substitutable in that sense. So, and it went on to do very well with respect to the performance. So we have increasingly bought a little bit of step three and step four beneficiaries, but we are keeping a watch on that. And at an opportune time, we will kind of get into some of the select names within that. Go to slide number, 40. Maybe we'll directly, let me explain the portfolio characteristics. After that. Sorry, 36. Slide number 36. Yes. So now, so this is what you get. These are the portfolio characteristics in a nutshell. So as I told you, currently we own about 65 stocks. Again, it's a multi-cap portfolio with a lot of mid and small cap companies based on US standards. So despite that, the overall median market capitalization on a weighted average basis is about $20 billion. It's a growth
Sandeep, I think Nilesh has gone offline due to some technical issues. So if you can continue from here.
You can hear me?
Yeah, you're audible.
Yeah. Thanks. Thanks, Nilesh. Moving on, Martin, we can come to the slides on performance. Yeah. Just to highlight from where Nilesh has actually left. So, in terms of track record, if you see this fund has a more than two decades of track record, and both in dollar terms and rupee terms, if you see across time frames, whether it is 3, 5, 7, 10 years and beyond, the fund has delivered better returns as compared to the benchmark. So, if you look at a 10-year period in dollar terms, the fund has delivered 16.51% kind of returns as compared to benchmark, which has delivered 12.83%. In INR terms, obviously INR has been depreciating against dollar, so in INR terms the returns are slightly higher. So in a 10-year period, the fund has delivered 22.62% CAGR returns as compared to benchmark, which has delivered 18.75. But more importantly, what we want to highlight is maybe in the next couple, just move on to that risk reward slide, Balchan. So no, next slide. Next slide. Next. One more. Yeah. So what we want to highlight here is that in this, what we are actually trying to depict is, if you see, there is risk and return. So return is on your y-axis, and risk, is, which is actually measured by standard deviation, is on your x-axis. And what this actually you can say depicts is you can say various scenarios across various scenarios. So we have taken Nifty 50 as a benchmark. So if you see, if you invest 100% of your investment into Nifty 50, which is depicted by light green triangle, inverted triangle, as you can see from there, Nifty has delivered 9% returns over last 5 years. Whereas in terms of standard deviation, it is at 18.5. So what we're trying to highlight here is, if you add maybe 10, a small portion to global funds, like 10 to 20 or 30% of your exposure into global funds. So if you see 20% of your investment is in global, and maybe 80% is into domestic market, which is basically, we have taken, for example, we have taken Nifty in this case. So which is depicted by that yellow button. So if you see, your overall portfolio return is also enhancing. But more importantly, or commensurately, your risk is coming down. So what we are trying to highlight here is, and this is a 5-year data. If you go to the next slide, similar kind of dispersion is there in the 10-year data also. So Balchan, you can move over to the next slide, please. Yeah. So that's actually, if you add 20% of global fund into your portfolio, and 80% is into domestic market, which is depicted by Nifty, as you can clearly see here as well, that not only your portfolio return is enhancing, but yes, more importantly, your risk, which is actually measured by standard deviation, is coming down at a portfolio level. So what we clearly actually depict from these two slides, and these are historical data of last 5-10 year data, so which clearly demonstrates that there is low correlation between markets, and it actually helps you if you diversify across markets. Sum up before we actually open up for Q&A. So as Nilesh highlighted, and as we have been highlighting, as the name suggests, the fund is actually it's a consumer trends fund. So it actually invests into themes which are actually based on consumer behavior and preferences and tastes, and two important you can say pillars which actually go into the decision making of a fund manager is, one, which is how consumers are spending their time, two, how they are spending their money. So these are two important pillars based on which actually the overall portfolio is constructed. The benefits of the actually investing to this kind of scheme, one is obviously you get to invest into businesses which are not available in India. They might be doing business in India. They might be using their products or services. Then there are business lines, as Nilesh highlighted, like a gaming or a home improvement, which is either an unorganized play, or they are actually simply, we don't have options, at least in the listed space, to actually invest into those kind of names or participate in their story. Apart from that, the second and more important benefit from this fund is that it's a differentiated positioning. There is hardly 10 to 12% overlap with the existing, you can say, peer set, which is available for investing into global funds. So it clearly actually, if you are investing 15 to 20% of your investments into global funds, this can fit into every client's portfolio. You can actually allocate 5 to 7% within that 15, 20% which you are investing into global funds, as it's a differentiated strategy and the portfolio is unique as compared to what are the offerings which are available right now in the market. Apart from that, just to actually sum it up in terms of portfolio construction, 70% of the portfolio is into new age consumer trends. And by new age consumer trends, what we mean is we are investing into names like e-commerce, entertainment, experiences, and internet and social media. So those are the names which are actually there in the portfolio, which are new age consumer trends. And 30% of the portfolio is into traditional consumer discretionary names, which actually have names from apparels and footwear or a home improvement or auto. Within auto, what we have is we are actually investing into online retailers. So which Nilesh highlighted in detail, I think that's quickly an update on the product itself. It's a multi-cap strategy. 40 to 50% of the portfolio is into mid and small cap. So with this thing, we will stop here. Maybe we can take questions now.
Sure, Sandeep. Thank you so much, Sandeep. Thank you, Nilesh.
Yes.
So I think this is the right product for all the investors looking to diversify their portfolio geographically as well. Taking the maximum advantage of the fast changing consumer trend that everyone is going through, and we have very few options available in India, wherein we have businesses having unique ideas, doing global disruption when it comes to a lot of sectors. So this funds will definitely give the investors the platform to make their investment in such companies as well. Coming to the questions, I think the most common question that we come across in all our webinars is the first one is looking at the current the position that the market is globally. So is it the right time to go ahead with a lump sum investment, or you would recommend to go ahead with the SIP? So what would be, what's your take on it?
Yeah, so let me address a part of that. Maybe Sandeep will also add his comments on that. So first and foremost, if you would have observed, a majority of the constituents which we own are secular beneficiaries. I mean, it's not that, we just see these companies are going to benefit from 1 or 2 years and then it'll fizzle out. So we certainly think that these companies, a majority of the companies which we own are going to do well over the next 3 years, 5 years, 10 years. So in that context, one has to see the valuation in that context, and also the fact that some of these companies have in itself a lot of embedded opportunities, like the e-com companies would have their own embedded fintech arms or healthcare arms, which in itself are very huge, are very small at this juncture, but when they are sold along with the main offering, I mean, they create a huge potential. So we believe some of the companies, a majority of the companies which we offer are in that basket, and you have to see the valuation context of that. Having said that, 25p multiple at the portfolio level we believe is reasonable. Obviously the markets have gone up, but we have, being value conscious, we have selected as well as position size in such a way that the overall portfolio level p is about 25, which to our mind is reasonable. Sandeep, you want to add anything?
Yeah. Just to add on that, Balchan, if you go back to the portfolio characteristics, right, what Nilesh is highlighting. So in terms of P, what he's highlighting is that we are actually in valuation terms, we are actually in line with the almost in line with the benchmark, which is our forward P is actually expected P is 25 as compared to benchmark, which is at 24.7. But more importantly, if you see the PEG ratio, which is the earnings growth, price to earning divided by earnings growth, nothing but what exactly you are the kind of earnings growth you are expecting over the next couple of years. So in PEG terms, obviously the PEG of ratio of the portfolio is 1.3, which is actually quite attractive as compared to the benchmark, which is at 1.6. And as you can see from this slide, both in revenue terms and as well as earnings term, whether you look at historical data or you look at 3 year forward data as well, so the fund is actually positioned well as compared to the benchmark. In addition to that, as Nilesh highlighted, anyone who is actually looking at valuation currently, so maybe you can invest 40-50% currently and you can stagger your remaining investments over 6 to 12 months. So yeah, so that's a quick this thing. SIP is a different play. So that's for lump sum, as you highlighted for SIP. So it's a good fund. It's a underlying fund is an equity fund, and since it's a secular consumer trend kind of, obviously the portfolio will change color as and when the consumer behaviors and preferences actually change. Along with that, this portfolio will also change. So it makes if you are actually investing for long term and if you want to do a SIP, it's a good product for SIP in fact. Yeah.
So this is the last question that we'll take due to time constraint, which is Vishal Bhatia would like to know whether the portfolio stock holdings will be disclosed once it is listed.
So it's an existing product. This is not a new. Although the new the Indian product, basically what we are launching is a feeder fund. So what we are launching is a fund of fund which will be investing into the already existing fund at a global level, which is Invesco Global Consumer Trends Fund. So this underlying fund has a track record of 20 years, and you have portfolio which has been there, and obviously the portfolio, as I was highlighting, that portfolio changes color as per the consumer behaviors and preferences. So that is a live portfolio. So it's not that it's a new fund that where once we collect the money and then we will be investing into those kind of names. It's already existing portfolio. As you can see from this slide also, the top 10 holdings are as on 31st of October. These are the top 10 holdings, which I think Nilesh has actually covered most of the names, whether it is Amazon, Alibaba. So Penn National Gaming and Caesar Entertainment are into online sports betting as well as online. So these are casinos, online casino, and as well as we have regional casinos with Caesar Entertainment, Amazon. All of us know Alibaba is what Amazon does globally. Obviously, Alibaba is a China play. Lois is a home improvement company. C Limited is into you can say video games as well as they are into e-commerce as well. JD.com is e-commerce based out of China. Farfetch, I think Nilesh covered, which is a luxury e-tailer. Nintendo as well as Activision Blizzard, both are gaming companies. So broadly, the portfolio is already there. These are the top 10 holdings, and it's an ongoing portfolio.
Yeah. So what you will get on a regular basis is top 10 holdings. See, they are in US in as per the UCITS guidelines, they disclose the portfolio once in 6 months. So that way, the entire portfolio. But you will get a good color on a monthly basis by looking into their fact sheet, which covers their top 10 holdings as well as the top overweight, top 10 overweight, top 10 underweight, top active attributors, negative attributors. So you will get a flavor of what's been owned latest, okay, by accessing that, which is available on a monthly basis.
Thank you, Nilesh. Thank you, Sandeep, for taking out the time this evening and joining in this webinar to help our investors understand all about this NFO and what it has got to offer the investors. So with this, we end this webinar. Thank you, participants, for joining in for the webinar. Have a wonderful evening.
Thank you, Saju. Thank you. Everyone for logging in for this discussion. Thank you once again. Take care. Stay safe. Have a nice week ahead. Thank you. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you.